Turning a day photo into a night photo in Photoshop doesn't have to be difficult, as you will see, because in this video we'll take this obvious day image and we're going to turn it into a super cool night scene with a stunning galaxy in the background. Welcome back everybody, my name is Phillip from letsimage.com and we are here with another totally complete editing tutorial. For anyone looking for inspiration for their own edits or just wanting to check out workflows to potentially adapt. We will start with adding a sky to the image, then make sure we change and adapt the color of the foreground to match the sky, and finally add some global adjustments to really bring the image together. I'll try to keep the tips as general as possible so that you may do the same with your own images. Let's go! To start, as I always do, I create a copy of my original layer by hitting Command or Control and J on your keyboard. Now we need to add our new sky in. If you don't have a sky that you want to add, use pages such as Canva or Pexels, which I will of course put the links for in the description. To get the sky into the image, there are several options. In my photo, I have a clear separation between this really wide sky and the rocks in the foreground. I do recommend using photos where this is the case and that are also neutrally lit, meaning no crazily blown out highlights or clipped darks. That's just a tip to make it a little bit easier to work with, but I mean, anything really goes in Photoshop. You know what else goes? Your thumb on that subscribe and like button. And also my dignity, which goes down the YouTube drain. Now, because of the nice separation, I had to edit and select sky replacement. Under sky, select the sky that you found online or shot yourself, and play with the settings to make sure the new transition looks at least neat. I'm going to shift my edge a bit, remove the edge fading, flip the sky, reduce the foreground lighting, get some more edge lighting, and increase the color adjustment a bit. The color adjustment will try to adapt the color of your foreground to the color of the sky, but with a dramatic change like that, it doesn't really do much, to be honest. If you feel that your transition between your sky and your foreground isn't that amazing, you can use the sky brush and add or remove some sky areas. Like in this gap here, I can paint in here to tell Photoshop I need more sky here. Do take your time with this. The better you work now, the less stress you have later. I'm doing a little bit quickly now, but you know, as I said, be careful in your own photos. Now, set the output to new layers and hit OK. Even if the process wasn't perfect, don't worry too much. You see that Photoshop creates a folder with all the layers and you can edit and change things as you need to as you go along. I'm happy with this, considering we'll darken the hell out of this in a moment anyway, so let's move on. Now we need to make sure that our foreground starts to fit the sky, especially in terms of color as well as brightness. If you have other objects that you're bringing into your image, also perspective, but we don't have that, so let's focus on these two. To start, I'll change the color of the grass. It's way too orange and I want a bit more green or cyan color. For this, you can use a hue saturation layer, select the yellows on the top dropdown, and change the hue until you have something that makes sense. Remember, we want to make sure the colors are fitting, so having orange really doesn't fit my image well, I feel at least. So let's make it bluish. Let's also bring down the saturation and the lightness of the grass a little bit. Okay, this looks sweet, so moving on. Next, let's start to work on the overall color of the foreground. After creating a new layer, I'll fill it with a blue to match my sky. You can even sample the color from the sky if you want to. For that, you could, for example, hit G or Shift G on your keyboard to select your bucket tool, hold the Options key to get the color selector and select the color you like, and click to fill the layer with. Now we can change the layer blend mode to color and reduce the opacity to maybe around 25%. Now we are starting to get rid of this yellow tone. Let's add a curve adjustment layer and change to a blue curve. And increase it a bit. Adding another curve adjustment will turn down the brightness a good bit. I don't like how it's darkening these spikes here, so let's make sure we have the layer mask selected and use a black brush with an opacity of maybe 20% and remove the darkness from the areas where we don't like it. With that done, let's go a bit more extreme. Using a color balance adjustment, I push the shadows a bit towards cyan and blue, and the highlights get some blue too. I know this looks like a lot, but bear with me. Now that we have a strong color that matches the sky to a degree, we can prepare for global adjustments. Looking at the image, I know that I'm going to increase the colors in the sky for sure. So the last thing I'll do to the foreground itself is to use a hue saturation layer to reduce the saturation overall a bit. Cool, let's work globally on the whole image. We can do this simple to start with using the camera raw filter. Make sure you have your top layer selected, which should be the folder with the sky, and hit Command or Control, Option, Shift and E to create what is called a stamp visible. This just copies everything that you can see in this moment onto a new layer. Next, go to Filter and Camera Raw Filter. Once there, let's create a radial mask. I want to ultimately draw attention to the Milky Way as well as to the bottom part of, like the bottom center part of the photo itself. And using a radial mask, we can increase the texture and clarity in this area a lot. We can also try bringing up the exposure a notch, but I'm not sure how that'll look. Anyway, once done, let's add another gradient mask and reduce the brightness coming from the lower right. There is nothing of interest there, and an easy way to guide the eye of the viewer is by using brightness. So if there's nothing there, let's make it dark. Once we are done with that, we're gonna hit OK and switch it up using a curve adjustment layer. Once more, let's bring that brightness down a good bit, hit Command or Control and I to hide the effect, and now we can use a white brush to bring that darkness back where we want it. I want to make sure the edges of the image are darker, so let's get into painting. In your image, you will have to decide whether or not to add highlights. For example, there could be a moon, of course, in that scene somewhere behind me as the photographer, let's say, and it would make sense if maybe it shines on a particular stone or something like that. That is up to you. I don't feel like I need it in my image right now. Instead, I want to make the bottom left even darker. Same thing, another curve adjustment, and let's brush that reduced brightness in where we need it. Okay, we are getting there. Now, in your photos, you could now find a cool LUT that you like, which is which stands for lookup table and just means a specific color style if you're not happy with the one that you have. But in my case, I don't need that or don't want that, but I do want to add some color. So let's create a hue saturation layer and increase the general saturation. I'm only looking at the sky right now. Let's also switch to the magentas, bring that up a bit too. And finally, with the layer mask selected, hit Command or Control and I to hide the effect. And once more, with a white brush, I'll add it into that awesome spot right here. Last not least, let's create another stamp visible, head to the camera raw filter again, and let's add a vignette to really round the photo up nicely. I'll also push the temperature a little towards the blue overall, and I'll also add a touch of vibrance. Saturation will push all colors in the image at the same time, whereas vibrance starts with the undersaturated areas first. Let's hit OK, and that's it. Now trust me, add a curve adjustment layer, increase the brightness a tiny notch, and now stop working on the image. Come back later to see if certain colors are too strong, if certain areas are too bright, or if the vignette was too strong. Anything goes. And there we go, looking at the complete before and after, quite a progress for a couple of minutes in Photoshop. Do try it out. It is a lot of fun to create these kind of night scenes in Photoshop. There are many ways of doing it, but sometimes you'll have images that you just have no other use for. Now, as usual, if you do like videos like that, do make sure to hit that subscribe button as well as that like button because, you know, it supports the channel, if that is what you desire to do. Other than that, stay safe and I'll see you next time. Bye!